the ways in which we unwittingly perpetuate racism through our structures, through our, even through our spirituality.
Those very same counties that overproduce debt, right, are the same counties that clear the fewest felonies, lowest percentage of felonies.
And they really don't have much context or history about the salience of race as an issue in the United States.
I'm Brian Wade. Watch me every week on this station.
Why do you and me have to be worlds apart? Oh, love is still the answer.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Worlds Apart. You can create a better world. I'm your host, Brian Wade. As you see, I guess with the new sort of addition to the title of Worlds Apart, you notice that I have You Can Create a Better World. And really that's about this ongoing desire on my part to provide information that will provide higher levels of insight around how can we better address and interact with each other as humans. And as you look around the world, there's so many conflicts that are going on about power and control that the desire of this program has always been about trying to be proactive and what can we do to heighten people's ability to better interact with each other and make the world we want it to be. And I'm privileged to have as my guest this week, and last week you saw part one in our series, Dr. John DeMartini, and he's my guest for part two in our series. And I want to thank him for taking the time. Right now he's in San Francisco, California. He's my phone guest. But again, I want to introduce for our guest this week, Dr. John DeMartini. Welcome to Worlds Apart, Dr. DeMartini.
Well, thank you for having me again.
Yes, well, with the advances in media, we can say we're talking again for part two in our week later. But again, thank you. Well, thank you for being on the program. We're highlighting some of your books, which we'll do later on in the program. But we're having a discussion regarding, I guess, from your perspective, how we can go about trying to better address issues on one level that we call racism or ethnocentrism. And on program one, you shared some of your perspectives, but as we were preparing for part two, let's just get right and hit the ground running. You know, it's your perspective that color really doesn't matter. And I'll allow you to elaborate further on that. But in places like America, which I grew up in, people have historically have made value judgments based on looking at the color of a person's skin. I'm not saying that in some ways that it's legitimate, but for whatever reason, they are victims to some extent of misinformation. I know in a lot of your books, you talk about value systems. Depending on how people have treated others, do you consider that a correct value system? Do you make judgments about those kinds of things?
Well, you're asking a guy who's been exploring that for a long time, and what I always do when somebody critiques me, criticizes me, rejects me, instead of me buying into the illusion of what their perception is, what I do is I look for who's praising me and look for the other side. Okay. I always look for the balance in life. And when I do, I don't get reactive, I get active. Mm-hmm. And so what we do is we become victims of our incomplete perceptions instead of looking whole at what the balance of life is. Because for every time somebody negates me, there's somebody that's affirming me somewhere if I look carefully enough. Mm-hmm. And if nothing else, it unites groups of people. Sometimes when people get criticized, they unite and they empower by gathering into groups. Mm. So we have to look at both sides if we want to do it. And just because somebody looks at your color and they react, well, that's a sign of their ignorance. Mm. It's not about color. Humans are humans. Mm. But what happens is if they have a reaction to color, that's because of their ignorance. Mm. That's why education is the crucial thing in this whole dynamic. Because if we educate people and we educate ourselves, the future holds a different destiny.
Right, and that's really the basis for this program. I'm not saying I'm the end-all and be-all, but I understood early on that in America, and I guess you could say around the world, that there wasn't enough substantive conversation and ongoing conversation around how can we better address some of the misinformation that's been propagated. As you're well-learned in a lot of the ologies, you look at science and some of the misinformation that they've done through the social sciences, specifically some of the earlier research in anthropology, that now with the onset of microbiology and genetics, we've been able to, in some ways, clear up a lot of the misinformation. So programs I felt like this were needed, especially on television, because I don't see much of that, were needed to, in some ways, create a constructive conversation around a pretty volatile issue. Do you agree that we need more of that kind of programming?
Well, I just find that the more ignorant we are, the more biased we are, and the more we are reacting reactive, and the more aware we are, the more inclusive we are, and the more loving we are. And so I try to educate people. Mm-hmm. You know, I have friends of almost every color and race and nation and creed, mm-hmm. and I mean, they're human beings. Mm-hmm. They're all worth it. I always say that no matter what you've done or not done, you're worthy of love, and no matter who you are or where you come from, you're worthy of love. That's right, the truth. Right.
I wanted to sort of touch on one book because I think it really encapsulates, I guess, the heart of what we're dealing with now, and that was a book called The Heart of Love, How to Go Beyond a Fantasy to Find True Relationship Fulfillment. And I think we could apply that, I'm almost certain we could apply it to ethnic relationships. Could you try to contextualize that for me, if you would?
Yeah, well, see, well, every human being has a set of values, and they are making decisions according to those values, and what they see in the world and what they act upon in the world is based on those values. Anytime you project your values onto them, they're going to betray you because the only thing that they can live is their value system. They're not here to live yours. They're there to live their own. If you can't see how their value system serves you, that's your box. That's your exclusivity. That's your own ignorance. Because everyone serves on this planet, or they wouldn't be here. They serve. So wisdom is finding out what that other person's values are, or that other nation's values for that matter, and finding out how it serves your nation or your individuality. And when you can say thank you for them as they are and love them for who they are, which is what everybody wants, then what happens is it works. The relationship works. Anytime you try to project your values onto them and try to get them to be more like the way you want them, you're going to get resistance and conflict. And anytime you appreciate and love people for who they are, you're going to get assistance and you're going to get feedback in the sense of an embrace. So if you want to transform the conflicts between individuals or nations, for that matter, we have to understand each individual value systems and find out how it serves. I have in my book, The Heart of Love, I have a whole chapter on how to link anybody's value system to your own. Because there's not a value system in the world that doesn't serve. Everybody serves. In the world, for every value system, there's a complete opposite value system. And I think, as a joke, the purpose of marriage is to face and prepare yourself to meeting your opposite kind of thing. Mm-hmm. But the reality is that if you can take and embrace your opposite and love that instead of having it as a disowned projection, you can love anyone. And I guarantee you it's not about color or race. It's about value systems. And you got to learn how to appreciate all value systems. They all serve. They all have a place in the world.
We have like a minute, so I'll at least set the question and we can come back and address it. But you talk about value system and embracing or understanding a person's value system. But how do you love someone when they don't mean you well? You know, and how do you find a positive when you have at times groups, whether in America or around the world, that look to bring about your demise? How do you love them in spite of that?
Well, I would say that what that does is it makes me organize myself with the people that I care about, and we gather and we organize and we strengthen ourselves, we empower ourselves. Everything, even that, has a value. Mm-hmm. We got to look at it. See, if we sit there and become the victim, we never gain our power. We get into blame, we never empower ourselves.
Right.
We have to live beyond blame. We have to find out how it serves us and use it to our advantage. When somebody goes after me and criticizes me and tries to destroy me and attack me, I get stronger, I get organized, I go and empower myself, I end up leading, I stand up for myself. I always find the blessings out of it and move forward, and then thank them for strengthening me and organizing me.
Okay.
I don't look at it as a victim, because if I do, then I'm wanting to you know, retaliate back instead of finding out how to empower my life.
Very good. Dr. John, we're going to pause for words from my sponsors. If you're just not tuning in, I have with me as my guest Dr. John DeMartini, noted author, scholar, sociologist, whatever ology you want to look at, he's probably studied. So what we'd like to do now is pause for words from our sponsors. Stay tuned, we'll be back to Worlds Apart. You can create a better world.
Additional support for Worlds Apart is provided by the Bonton Stores Foundation.
When you want words like skilled, expert, and nationally recognized, when you need to have confidence as well as courage, when it's your health, your body, your life, we have the finest team of specialists waiting to help. WellSpan Health, the region's most comprehensive healthcare system. WellSpan Health, for the journey that is life.
Having quality childcare is basic to what we do here at Basic Steps. We provide a safe, caring, supervised, and academically stimulating environment for our children. If you are in need of quality child care service that will provide comfort and security, join our family here at Basic Steps. Basic Steps is certified and licensed by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. Basic Steps Daycare Center has a collaborative association with the Harrisburg School District and is aligned with the Keystone Star child care requirements. Child care subsidies are available if you qualify. Call us here at Basic Steps, 717-232-1466. You'll be glad you did.
Why do you and me have to be worlds apart? All of us feel the answer.
Welcome back to Worlds Apart. You can create a better world. I'm your host, Brian Wade. If you're just not tuning in, I have Dr. John DeMartini, who's my guest. And as we were sort of taping the program, we have some visitors that are going to be on some of the following programs, and they were listening intently to our discussion. So I thought, well, why not have them come on and ask a question of Dr. DeMartini? So I have a guest here. Sir, introduce yourself and to our audience, please.
My name is Emmanuel Brown.
Okay. Emmanuel, ask a question to Dr. DeMartini then, please, if you would.
Yeah, Dr. DeMartini, I certainly appreciate the point that you were making in regards to our empowering ourselves. My concern is that as we live in our world today, certainly there are individuals, as the point was brought out earlier, that really do not cause us any, well, really that does not look out for our in our behalf, that really seek to cause us demise. And as you brought out the point that you were making, we look beyond that, that we look within ourselves and move beyond that. Now, certainly efforts should also be to cope, deal, or endure, rather, in some form or fashion. And that's the question I have. What is it that we need to do to go beyond these individuals who do not seek to appreciate our values? How do we work with such ones?
Well, what I find is that people only want to bring about a demise. This is a kind of a metaphysical aspect here. We only want to bring about a demise on the outside to other people that represent parts of us we're trying to get rid of in ourselves. So we have to find out this person that wants to bring our demise. We have to find out what their values are, what they're trying to get rid of in themselves, their own disowned parts. And we have to learn how to communicate and find out what those needs are of that individual and then show how we can communicate in those needs. As I said a moment ago, if we have a person who's buying a product and we're selling to those needs, we have to find out what their needs are before we can sell the product, or otherwise they say no and they want to get rid of us. So we have to learn what that person's values are and communicate in it.
So,
and the art of doing that is what we want to master.
Go ahead.
The art of communicating. That's why I wrote the book, The Heart of Love, to help people learn the art of communicating in people's values so they're receptive to what we're dedicated to and we can honor what they're dedicated to.
So you're saying that there is a way, despite such ones who do not value...
But the only reason they want to eliminate us, if you will, is because we're somehow representing a part of them that challenges their values and reminds them of something in their past they haven't loved. I guarantee, I watch this every week in my seminars, and what happens is when they want to eliminate us because we remind them of that, and it keeps haunting them. If we find out what that is, what their needs are, what their values are, I assure you there's ways of communicating in those values and making them feel that they're getting what they want, and we can then get what we want.
And I guess
there is a way of uniting. I've seen people in major divorces and major conflicts mediated once we know that art and that science. And they were really wanting to just eliminate each other, as you know, and sometimes divorces. I've seen it also in races. I've seen people in the seminars with two different races going after each other, and we started the conversation, dialogue, and found out what their needs are, communicated their needs, and they softened and they were arm in arm to each other.
So, Dr. DeMartini, you're talking about people needing, I guess, skill sets in terms of communicating more effectively. But
that's
when
the education I was talking about. That's why it's so important to be educated, because it's our ignorance and our lack of knowing our strategies that make us just want to change them and fix them and get rid of them because they're reminding us of our incompetences.
Oh, go ahead.
But in a world that we obviously recognize that not everyone is equally educated, so how...
Well, that's so true, and that's why to kind of live in the fantasy that that's going to go away, what I dedicated my life to is research and education, because I realize that that is one of the most important components, is educating people on human behavior, understanding that the color is not really what it's about. It's about color. It's about our understandings. Because I've seen people that are two whites go after each other because of lack of education and knowing how to communicate in each other's values just as much as a black and white or red and a yellow. It doesn't
So tell them, Dr. DeMartini, they need to continue to watch Worlds Apart, right?
Well, Worlds Apart is obviously trying to bring the awareness to people and anything we can do to educate and expand. Look, when I was a child, I didn't even know about color differences. I just grew up in a neighborhood. I didn't know about it. Then my parents moved into an area that was about one-third Spanish, one-third Afro-American, and one-third white. I went in there, and I grew up, didn't know any difference there. I became friends with them, and they hung out with them, or rode horses with them, rode bikes with them. I didn't know anything about color. Mm-hmm. It wasn't until I turned about my teenage years that I started hearing about this. There's a difference there. So it's an education process, and that's why we have to exemplify that understanding as an individual. We have to dedicate ourselves. So many times we want to fix other people, and when it's really ourselves, we want to master ourselves and educate ourselves and love, learn how to love ourselves and love how people around us. We do that, we're actually starting a chain reaction, a ripple effect. I'm calling it the gratitude effect in a new book I'm coming out, How to Be Grateful for Ourselves and Other People, the way they are, because that's how people want to be loved.
Dr. DeMartini, though, when you look at our political structure, and I talked about this off the air, we have like a minute for this segment. Briefly answers, have you had opportunities to really speak to any of our politicians in terms of some of the social policies that are going on?
I wish I could say yes. In America, I've had very little influence on that. In Africa, I've had some. In different countries, I've had it. In Spain, I've had it. I have not had the opportunity to do it in America, but I hope to God I get the opportunity. I've sent letters off. I have not got responses that have been allowing me to do that yet, but I'm not stopping. I'm just beginning. So hang loose. Watch what happens.
Okay, very good. Well, I hope I can facilitate that somebody in Washington maybe will see this program or something. But
is that Emmanuel? Is that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
Just thank you for the question. I hope that was somehow of value. But all I know is that I always say that no matter what a person's done or not done or what they look like or whatever, they're worthy of love. And I come from that premise right from the beginning. That's how I run my life. And I'm interested in learning from people because I don't know of anybody that I haven't learned from. Mm.
Yes.
Well, that's why I end the program the way I do. The song by Vince Gill says, love is the answer. It's the only place to start. Why do you and me have to be worlds apart? So I want to thank Emmanuel, and we'll see you next week on our series where we're talking about diversity in public education. So I want to thank you for your question and for our listening on. This was really impromptu. It was first, and I think it was designed to happen, though, but I was sensitive to some of my audience people, and I saw how intently they were looking as they were asking questions. So we're going to pause for words from our sponsors. If you're just not tuning in, you're listening to Worlds Apart. You can create a better world. We'll be right back.
Through the Community Care Fund, United Way supports programs like the American Red Cross CPR training that saved Vilma Thompson's life.
I just say what a wonderful thing it is to be alive and know that you owe your life to somebody because they took the time to learn how to save a life.
I'd like to thank the community. I'd like to thank everyone that donates to the United Way. And I would like to ask those that don't donate to the United Way to find it in their heart to do so.
Additional support for Worlds Apart is provided by The Bon Ton.
Whether it's in the city, the country, or somewhere in between, owning your own home means something special, something comfortable and secure. No wonder it's a dream we all share. We're the Pennsylvania Housing Finance Agency, working to put safe, affordable housing within reach of every citizen. Find out more by visiting phfa.org, because it doesn't have to be just a dream.
Additional support for Worlds Apart is provided by Wolf Printing.
Why do you and me have to be?
Behold me to be self-evident that all.
Brian Wade. You can create a better world. We're live in the studio here, and we have another guest that was in our listening audience, and they were listening so very intently, and I just had a spontaneous idea to, why don't we just bring them out and let them ask Dr. John DeMartini a question. So we have our next questioner. Her first name is Shahida.
Yes.
Yes. Introduce yourself, please, and then you can ask your question.
Yes. My name is Shahida Muhammad, and I just wanted to tell you, you know, like I said before, that I am Muslim. And I have always worked and lived in an environment that has been diverse because I created a diverse environment for myself. But one thing that I'm finding that I even had explained to my children as they have begun to grow up about love, and I told them, always told them, that love doesn't have a color. And that if you're going to love someone, you love them based on their integrity and their truth. And those things are not exclusive for any individual or group of people. And my question to you is, living in an environment such as America, and sometimes people misread other people based on what they see in the media, what would be the best position to take in approaching persons who may be fearful of Muslims here in America?
Let me ask you this question, though. There are people that I think have overreacted when they hear the term jihad, you know, in terms of, you know, holy war. Do you think that's been taken out of context? Briefly, if you could respond to that, please.
Yes. In Islam, there are two types of jihad. Mm-hmm. But the greatest jihad is the jihad an-nas. Mm-hmm. And nas means self. Mm-hmm. That you are to work through and struggle and fight those weaknesses within yourself as an individual.
Exactly.
But the second jihad, which is to fight outside of yourself, mm-hmm. is not the triumphant jihad, because you never have control over anyone outside of yourself. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that I tell the students at the high school where I work is that you may look from the right and the left and in front of you and behind you, that you will only ever find yourself within yourself. Mm-hmm. You will never find yourself outside of yourself. Mm-hmm. And so I think this whole thing about jihad, even among Muslims, they don't understand what jihad is, because it's easy for you to pick up a weapon, but it's very difficult for you to remove those weapons and demons within mm-hmm. yourself. Mm-hmm. So I think that jihad has been misinterpreted, mm-hmm. but I think for myself that is a struggle. So this jihad an-nas has always been a struggle for me and other Muslims who choose to live their life according to Islam, which means literally peace and submission to the will of God. Mm-hmm. So I think for myself, living in an environment, those are the things that I've always tried to do, is to live a life of harmony and peace, and to receive and welcome people in my life to not make me afraid, but to enrich my life.
Dr. John, take about 30 seconds to respond to that, if you would, please.
And we're going
to
end. I can't say it except bravo.
Okay.
All I can say is that was wisdom spoken. Right. It was something we can all benefit from hearing. That was wisely stated. Mm-hmm. Bravo.
Mm, very good.
I can't say anything except that that's exactly what I would agree with.
Yeah.
She's saying it wisely. She's using the language that is understood. So thank you.
You're welcome.
And that's not that language wasn't just limited to Muslims, because it's a universal language, isn't it, Dr. John?
Yeah, that's it.
Right.
Look, well, our real nature is love. Mm-hmm. And anytime, and that's, I've asked millions of people if they had only 24 hours to live, what would they do? And they said, I'd like to communicate my love and appreciation to people who contribute to my life. And everyone wants to be loved and appreciated for who they are. So that's the core of our essence. And her message was to the core of our message, the essence. And so I can't say it except to say bravo and thank you.
Very good. Dr. John, I know we have like maybe 3 minutes left. I want to briefly introduce your information. I'd like to introduce your DVD called Life's Driving Force. Could you give us a brief overview about that?
Well, the purpose of that CD is to help people realize that when you have humbleness to divinity, you have certainty for humanity, and you have a mission and purpose and vision in your life that is spontaneously revealed from your heart, from love. Mm-hmm. And that CD or DVD is designed to assist people in waking that up and realizing they have something magnificent to contribute to the world as they are.
The next book I want to introduce is Count Your Blessings, The Healing Power of Gratitude and Love. Briefly?
Well, that Count Your Blessings is exactly what it means. more to be grateful for. Mm. I would say gratitude is the key that opens up the gateway of the heart and allows the love that sits there eternally ready to shine come out. And when we have gratitude for other individuals and ourselves, we share our love. And I can't emphasize that. That heals our body. It heals all areas of our life. And I'm working on a new movie called The Gratitude Effect right now just for that reason, because I believe that we have to be grateful for each other.
Yeah, I grew up with, as a child, it was a song that count your blessings, count them one by one, count your blessings, see what God has done. So it reminds me of that song I grew up as a child.
The next book, the essence.
Exactly. The next song is called The Heart of Love, How to Go Beyond Fantasy to Find True Relationship. Please, briefly.
Well, that book is about how the art of communicating what is inspiring to us in terms of the values and what's inspiring to other people, because that is like, just like in sales, if you don't know how to communicate your client or your customer's values, you get no, and you get resistance, and you don't get anywhere. You have to learn the art of communicating and establishing a rapport and knowing their values and communicating in their values, and the book is designed on how to master that and how to have more appreciation and love for the people around you.
And these are two books we got less than a minute. How to Make a Hell of a Profit and Still Get to Heaven.
Well, that book is about dissolving the conflict between our spiritual quest and our material quest. I always say spirit without matter is expressionless and matter without spirit is motionless. And you deserve to have a spiritual mission and also be rewarded financially so you can have the money to fulfill that mission in the world.
15 seconds in the final book, The Breakthrough Experience. Ladies and gentlemen, my guests, and it's been a privilege to have Dr. John F. DeMartini. Thank you so much, Dr. DeMartini. And I have a feeling.
Thank you, and God, thank you for the lovely questions, and just thank you.
Thank you so much. Take care of yourself. God bless you. For
God bless
World Apart, I'm Brian Wade. Good evening, good night, and God bless.
The African American History Minute. Today's trivia question is, who founded a fur trading post in what is now Chicago? Today's featured organization is Island Furs. Located in the Beverly Hills area of Chicago, it's the only African-American-owned and operated furrier in the Chicagoland area.
We're quality people, and sometimes, you know, being a black-owned operated company, people tend to see that maybe you're just a little inferior because you're black, but that's not the case here.
It's an honor to discover fine furriers in a city founded by a furrier more than 225 years ago.
Yes, we are full-service furriers. By full-service, we mean that we design, manufacturer, clean, store, retail, whatever there is that need to be done to furs, we do it right here at Island Furs.
Now, back to our trivia question. Who founded a fur trading post in what is now Chicago? The answer is Jean-Baptiste Dusable. Until next time, remember, we're standing on the shoulders.